we find a former NASA astronaut, Commander Kenneth Ham, as one of your advisors. Do you have big plans in space research?
How would you inspire other CEOs to engage more in nonprofit activities as a contribution for society?
Founders of things that are large now.
What is the synergy between your profit and nonprofit work?
Because nobody got paid. In fact, most of us didn't make, we lost money, if you will. You're an astronaut, but what do you know about satellites? And he says, dude, I was a satellite. That's the best line I've ever heard in my life.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Excellence Talk. As usual, together with Dr. Christian Forstner, we are welcoming an important guest from Las Vegas, United States, David Knight. In the first video, we talk about his company, Turbine, and today we will talk another interesting topic, and Christian will explain what we will talk today.
Absolutely, Murat. David is a founder and CEO of Turbine, a fast-growing startup providing the first global exchange for sensor data, but he's also a member of the Board of Trustees for the California Space Center Foundation, a nonprofit organization, and his active involvement in private spaceflight through the XPRIZE Foundation was preceded this involvement. David, on your Turbine website, we find a former NASA astronaut, Commander Kenneth Ham, as one of your advisors. So there seems to be a connection between your main business and space research. Do you have big plans in space research?
Well, I don't know about research per se. We have a very, especially myself and some of my partners in Turbine, are big space fans, if you will. And it's true that back in 2004, I was part of the original XPRIZE. XPRIZE more or less mapped to Roman numeral 10, and we offered $10 million to the first person or group who could build their own spaceship and get in it and leave the atmosphere like Alan Shepard did in the first suborbital American flight. And then in that year, in 2004, it was won by a group out of the Mojave Desert, which is only about 150 miles from where I'm sitting here in Las Vegas. We had teams from the Czech Republic and Argentina, Germany, the UK, Japan, almost all over the world. And it was really an amazing group of people. However, it happened to be won by the team that launched their rocket out of the Mojave Desert. That led to the creation of a company called Virgin Galactic Space Lines that is, you know, headed up by Virgin's group CEO, Richard Branson. And that company is actually a publicly traded company now in the United States. They hope to start actually flying humans sometime in the next year. Wow. That led to me just being around a lot of amazing heroes of mine. When we had those launches, you know, I met Neil Armstrong, who's no longer with us. I met Buzz Aldrin, who I still talk to once in a while, believe it or not. And Chuck Yeager, who I flew halfway across the country one time with. And these are my heroes, not just as a child, but now. And so I've always kept a hand in something to do with aerospace. But in 2011, NASA retired the space shuttles. And there, you know, we built six. So one was Enterprise, which is in New York now as a museum piece. It is hollow. It didn't go to space. So there was five that were the actual orbiters that went to space. Very tragically, you know, we lost the space shuttle Challenger in the ascent phase. We lost Columbia in the descent phase. That left three actual orbiters. The Smithsonian took one of them, the shuttle Discovery, which they now have on display. The NASA sort of visitor center in Cape Canaveral, Florida, they decided to keep the shuttle Atlantis there, and it's very magnificently presented. So that left one shuttle that could go somewhere else in the United States. They thought the West Coast should get one. So 270 institutions applied to get this shuttle awarded to them. It came down to 20 semifinalists, and then it pretty much came down to California versus Texas. And our foundation, the California Science Center Foundation, won, which is why you see a picture of the shuttle behind me. That's how it's currently presented in a temporary hangar. And that's in Los Angeles next to the Los Angeles Coliseum. Right next door, George Lucas is building his museum. So it's going to be really cool down there when this is all done. I keep my hand in that, one, because I'm really into STEM. Two, you know, I have a physics background. And so I kind of love things to do with high levels of engineering and so on. And it's a really important piece of aerospace history, these shuttles. So that led me to get to know a whole bunch of astronauts. I actually am super honored and privileged to consider some of them my friends. Somewhere in the middle of that, I was introduced to Commander Kenneth Ham, whom you mentioned. He is not only a two-time space shuttle commander, which means he's had his hands on the controls of the shuttle. He's also a rather well-known military test test pilot, for example, the F-18 Super Hornet. And after leaving NASA, he became the head of aerospace studies at the Naval Academy in Annapolis, Maryland. So he's an incredible guy. He knows a heck of a lot about orbital mechanics. You know, somebody once said to him in a meeting, so you're an astronaut, but what do you know about satellites? And he says, dude, I was a satellite. That's the best line I've ever heard in my life. Anyway, he's an incredible individual and very helpful when we talk about aerospace matters. When we started Turbine, we actually thought we might build our own constellation of small CubeSats that would orbit the Earth and do various sensing jobs. We quickly realized that a whole bunch of other companies were starting up to do that very thing, infrared, different bands of ultraviolet, infrared, radio waves, light. These are the ones that aren't for pictures. These are sensing satellites. And governments have had those for years, but not commercial enterprises or nonprofits. So that's what's going on now. That allowed us to focus Turbine on the data and the sort of information processing and not on the hardware. But nothing's out of the question as we grow our company.
Really interesting personally, because I love universe and I love aerospace, and like also probably comes from my genes, my son already 3 years old asking every day about the universe and the space. So probably we would love to visit the Cornea Science Center.
Absolutely. Please do. It's not open right now. We closed it around, I think, the end of March when COVID, you know, hit, really got big in the United States. But it's a beautiful center. And we're now going to build a bigger center, way bigger, that will be called, it'll be the Air and Space Museum for the Western United States. And it will have the shuttle mounted vertically, like it's about to take off. And we have real solid rocket boosters from Northrop Grumman, which we only got 2 weeks ago. We also have the last shuttle fuel tank on the Earth. And we moved that through the Panama Canal up to Los Angeles about 3 years ago. I was in the Panama Canal with it. It was really an amazing experience. And we reached literally before the shutdown, we were getting anywhere from 1.5 to 3 million people a year came to see all of this. So when we open the new Air and Space Center, we expect that number to go up even more. And it really affects a lot of young people. We've heard that a lot of kids have gotten excited about science. Now at Turbine, we have a big program of data acquisition that involves classifying and characterizing data feeds we get from government agencies and companies. And we're doing that with a whole bunch of either current or recently graduated engineering students. They're all dual major. So they have computer science or data science, and then they companion that with a physical science, aerospace, mechanical engineering, physics, could be theoretical physics, could be applied physics, could be nuclear physics. We also have people that come from urban planning and geology and fascinating things like that, because they need to know what they're looking at. And we're handling the data of the physical world. And that's why our tagline at Turbine is take the pulse of the Earth, which we intend to do. So I think we'll always have not only a STEM component, but a science component, and probably more and more, you know, we call the data feeds from satellites as more and more of those sensing satellites go into orbit.
You are a member of the Board of Trustees for the California Science Center Foundation, which was awarded the last space shuttle by NASA. As the executive producer, you covered Space Shuttle Endeavour's final 3 nights, 3 days journey through the streets of the Los Angeles. The Hollywood-like film is breathtaking. What inspired you to do it without any payment?
Yes, nobody got paid. In fact, most of us didn't make, we lost money, if you will. Well, frankly, it's really a labor of love. Again, I'm just a huge STEM supporter. I'm a big space fan. And when we realized we were actually getting one of the few space shuttles, shortest possible story is that I actually started talking. I said, well, we're doing this in Hollywood's front yard, so why don't I get Hollywood to help? And I found out immediately that everybody had these big schedules. And I talked to very famous directors. I was able to get meetings with just people that are household names because it's a space shuttle. However, nobody seemed to be able to figure out that they had to kind of drop everything because the shuttle was coming on the top of a 747 to LA, and it was an unchangeable schedule. So I finally said, you know what, I'm just going to film this myself. I don't really know what I'm doing, but applied physics, I know a lot about light. So So I'll start with the fundamentals. So what was really amazing is I started, as I said, I sort of rang the bell in Hollywood and said, come help. And there's no money. We don't even have money for coffee. That's true. There was no film budget. And at one point, with a lot of contributions from large companies and individuals, I think I had 310 people on the film crew at one point. 310, and not a single one was somebody's friend who was hanging out. It was all vital people. No, not even those production assistants that go get you lattes. We didn't have any of that. It was all engineering type people and technical people and cameramen. I had 4 Academy Award winning camera and special effects people, 100% donated. So I took the role of sort of the master, you know, a cat herder, we would say. And I also brought a lot of the resources together. And that is why I was called executive producer. In Hollywood, executive producer usually means the money. Since we didn't have money, it was more like I bring the resources. And I had some wonderful partners in that whole effort. Most notably, Toyota made a huge donation and they even provided almost half the film crew themselves. I mean, it was really cool. I would do it again, even though there were a couple days where I stayed awake for literally over 30 hours. I mean, not even taking a nap, because we had to move this through the streets and there was just always a problem of some kind. But I'd still do it again. And it was, so anyway, we ended up with an incredible amount of raw footage from helicopters and street cameras and all sorts of mountaintops. And it was about 270 hours of raw footage, including a lot of professional grade 3D footage. So we kind of sat there and said, well, what do we do with all this footage? And then a really brilliant director named Paul Bozomowski, he's out of New York, he and his team offered to edit this into a film. I then went to public television in the United States and I said, let's make a short film that we can offer on the air across the country, and they can use it as a fundraiser for public television. And public television hadn't done fundraising using science and space, believe it or not. They'd always use music. So it was very controversial, but it went on the air. They realized it was going to work and was going to actually be a hit. So they kept playing it for a year. And after that year expired, I said, well, now I'm going to put it online and make it free to everybody. And that's what you're going to put the link in there for. It's about 24 minutes, by the way. It's not a long film.
Yeah, I watched it. Every minute is worth it. I can really, really recommend it.
One of my favorite shots in there, you'll see in the film, everybody who goes and looks, the shuttle we have moved out of this giant robot through the streets of LA, which took 3 nights and 3 days. We didn't count the journey across the United States on the 747 in that, because it's kind of esoteric, but the actual physical journey through the streets on this giant 500,000-pound robot, which was made in Germany, brought to the United States, and then we mounted the shuttle on this giant machine. We used LIDAR, laser radar, to scan possible routes. There's many, many, many possible routes, but only a few routes could accommodate something that wide. 79 feet, 1/4 inch. I'd have to do what that is in meters. But it's a huge object to move through a city street. So there kind of came down to just sort of this one pathway. And it couldn't go on motorways. It couldn't go under bridges. You know, there's a lot of restrictions. They had to move whole parts of infrastructure. And you can see all that in the film. But this one moment, it kind of got stuck in a residential neighborhood. And the reason it did is the people using the LIDAR had it mounted on a truck going through the streets. And they hadn't realized that Boeing would add this thing you'll see in the film called it's a support bracket that interfaces the robot to the bottom of the shuttle. And it's this very massive piece of metal and it adds height. So that was just enough for the wings to almost hit this huge tree and an apartment building. So it just got stuck there for hours. That is only maybe 3 minutes of the movie, but it was hours in real time. So I had so much time. I said, you know, this is so ridiculous. The space shuttle is stuck by an apartment building. And so I went down to the airport and I got a helicopter, and it was guys I knew from Hollywood, and we put out the whole filming rig, switched it all on, and we came in really low. And when you see the film, that shot is real. That's not a zoom. We actually brought this helicopter. We got permission to bring it down to where it was blowing on people, but the shot is incredible. So yeah, it was a lot of fun adventures in moving a space shuttle through a giant city.
I had to watch this scene twice, I think, to understand that it's not made up, David. And to our listeners, you know, you've got to watch this, please. Okay. David, we now know how heavily you're engaged in nonprofit activities. Besides your main job as a CEO of Turbine, probably challenging enough, what is the synergy between your profit and nonprofit work?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So I originally, before starting Turbine, I was on a fair number of nonprofit boards, all STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics oriented. I also was in various capacities involved with other startups. I either was an investor, what they call an angel investor, or I was on their board of advisors, or I was on their board of directors, or my friends ran the company and asked for my help sometimes. I dropped all of it when I started Turbine for the simple reason that I knew it would take 100% of my focus, you know, all the time. And so fortunately, my serious day-to-day involvement with the space shuttle had wrapped up by that point, actually 4 years before that. So I decided that I would, of course, remain involved with the space shuttle. So I'm not on the main board of directors because that does require a lot of effort. I'm on the board of trustees, which means a lot of interesting things. But, you know, we do things like, you know, try to raise money for the foundation through our contacts. We'll also, you know, we show up for the big events. But I don't think I could ever contribute as much to that whole effort as having made that film with these great people and getting it on television. It was on Dish Network and DirecTV in North America. I mean, it was really well publicized. However, Turbine, I think as we grow, we're still, you know, effectively a nascent company. I think we will start to branch out. So the first thing in that vein is citizen science. It benefits us commercially as well as on the STEM side to encourage people to capture sensor data, process sensor data. And the application showcase that we launched this week is really neat. If you go to turbine.com, you can just see, you know, the applications. And these are mostly made by university students, and they're amazing. So you'll have, I mentioned, you know, that we do have some satellite data in there. We also have all this interesting data from streets and mountaintops and ships. And when you put all that into the brain of a grad student, they come out with amazing things. And they're writing code. They use Python most of the time, you know, for scientific analysis or something more complicated. And they'll use like MATLAB and plug things in and come out with cool visualizations and correlations. And the reason we're doing that, why that helps us commercially, is it helps people in companies and government agencies to look at those applications and say, oh, I see how I could apply that in insurance. I see how I could apply that in financial services. I see how I could apply that in logistics. Some of those very applications that were literally generated by students are being looked at right now by a whole bunch of analysts at major, major insurance companies. And saying, oh, this is great. I didn't think you could correlate, you know, road conditions to accidents to air quality or something like that. It's really interesting. I think we're only scratching the surface because the Internet of Things is only just beginning. When you see what's going to happen with the introduction of 5G around the world, they're kind of saying it's there. It's not really there yet, but it'll be there within the next few years. 5G is so optimal for machines talking to machines. It's actually way beyond what you can do with 3G or 4G in that respect. So we're really excited. We've been approached by a number of the big phone companies in various countries in the United States to start to help them figure out, you know, how are they going to deal with machines in 5G? And that'll all benefit from this experimentation that, you know, our citizen science are doing.
Wow, almost unlimited opportunities for our generation and the next one, David. Murat, I think we have a last question.
Yes, I have the last question. David, most CEOs I know are not as much engaged in philanthropy as you are. How would you inspire other CEOs to engage more in nonprofit activities as a contribution for society?
You know, I like that question a lot because it does come up. I know a lot of CEOs, mostly founders, but some are founders of things that are large now. And I think we're all kind of geeks. You know, we all love science and technology a lot. Everybody wants to be the first with this new Apple Watch. You know, just, ooh, I got to have it today. I don't, by the way, I'm on Android, but anyway. So I think it's interesting that in subtle ways, a lot of them do support STEM and philanthropy, but it kind of has to do with your passion. You know, if you look at Bill Gates, it's the ultimate, you know, example of a very, very successful tech entrepreneur. You know, what he does isn't as sexy as what Elon does, but at least, I mean, if you could say who has really affected the world, Microsoft in the last 30 years has just massively affected the world. Without them, we probably wouldn't be doing this right now. So I think if you look at, you know, but he and his wife, you know, created the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and their philanthropy is all about healthcare, which right now on everybody's minds, other people get involved with other things. And I think it just really does have to do with what they're passionate about. However, there are things a company can do to help that don't bite into the bottom line, including our support for citizen science, getting young people excited about science and engineering. And also, you know, I think you'll see more and more, you know, when they go to what they call the exit, where you've gone public or sold your company to a large company, then you get this pot of money and then people decide what to do individually. So I, like I said, I really have focused everything on the California Science Center and our new air and space complex, and which is not just a physical place. It's going to be, you know, a lot of virtual stuff around that goes around the world. What I will say is everybody in technology really understands that we have to get young people excited about science and technology, because we need the next generation of, you know, scientists, engineers, inventors. And if they don't get exposed to that, it might not even occur to them that that's a path for them. In particular, I really applaud the people that are focusing on getting what they call diversity, especially women involved with science and engineering. We had last year when we moved our company from San Francisco to Las Vegas, I formed a good relationship with the big university here. They have about 3,300 undergraduate engineering students at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. About half of those have something to do with computer science or data science. And we just went to their career counselors and said, look, we need these types of people to be involved with our data acquisition group. And it was amazing. You know, close to half are young women. They've been incredible. I mean, the ones that we've hired, I mean, really, to use an American baseball analogy, they've knocked it out of the park. You know, they've just really done very well. So I really encourage not just STEM education, but widely diverse STEM education. And I think there's just no downside to companies supporting that.
Thank you very much for the inspiring insights. I'm sure that in the first video about Turbine, about your company, and today we talk about Space Shuttle, your nonprofit organization engagement, it really brings a lot of inspiration to our audience. Thank you very much again.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate doing this.
All the best to you, David.
All the best.